The Legend of Zelda is my favourite game franchise of all time, and even though I'm scripting these videos, I don't think I'm ever really going to be able to articulate how I feel about them. I'm going to try, and eventually I want to get through all the main console games and the games that meant the most to me. It's been 35 years since The Legend of Zelda started, so if I'm going to review all the main console games, I have to start from the beginning. I already did the first one at the end of last year, so let's move on to its sequel. This game is a departure from anything you'd associate with Zelda just by looking at it. Gone is the top-down perspective and instead goes for side-scrolling. Gone are the hearts representing health, opting for a health bar. You now level up with experience points, similar to RPGs, making it an actual requirement to not only fight enemies, but chances are you'll be doing some grinding when it's clear you're not at your best. I don't know how I feel about this. On one hand, I like the concept of a more RPG-based Zelda game, but on the other, they introduce some RPG elements and omit others, like equipable armor to further boost stats, or a difficulty curve. So Zelda II, The Adventure of Link, and I'm not being lazy with the title there, it's actually called Zelda II, not The Legend of Zelda, The Adventure of Link. It's Zelda II, The Adventure of Link. And it's a direct sequel to the first game. You play as the same old Link on another quest to save a different old Zelda. Very old Zelda, actually, because the story of Zelda 2 is thus. After Ganon was destroyed, Impa told Link a sleeping spell was cast on Princess Zelda. She will wake only with the power of the third Triforce, sealed in a palace in Hyrule. To break the seal, crystals must be blessed, blah blah blah. You get it. Except, that's actually quite a misleading version of what's happening, and for clarity, you need... The Zelda you're saving in this game is actually the very first Zelda, who was cursed after a magician was after the Triforce. Her brother, in his grief and guilt for helping the magician, then decreed that every girl born into the royal line should be called Zelda. Impa tells Link this, referring to it as the Legend of Zelda. I actually never knew there was a canon explanation as to why the games were called The Legend of Zelda. It's just a bit strange that The Legend of Zelda is explained in the instruction manual of the only Zelda game not to be called The Legend of Zelda. It's a bit fucking weird.
Link has been chosen to find the Triforce of Courage to unite with the other two Triforce pieces, Power and Wisdom, that you found in the last game, because they realised between these games that having a Triforce with only two pieces was stupid. So off we go! You start this time around in the palace of the sleeping Zelda, and you notice immediately that this is nothing like the opening of the original, because it's sideways. It's honestly really interesting to think of a time that Zelda was so new that they could just mess with it so much, especially when you head outside and see this madness. One of the RPG mechanics Zelda 2 also opted to integrate into this game was a chibi Link on an overworld map and random encounters, making it more akin to Final Fantasy than a Zelda game. And it looks disgusting. You've got this sprawling, undetailed, sparse map all zoomed out, and then when you fight, you get transported into this flat-landed, nothing area to fight or run from enemies. I can't believe I'm saying this, but the original Zelda game, for all its flaws, and considering I also called the overworld sparse, gives you a sense of scale and adventure, because it's a world to scale. You look at the map and yes, it looks like this, but you can track where you are exactly. Link fits into the world. Here you get this, which actually looks like this, which actually looks like this. There's no detail, just vagueness, and you end up losing a lot of the magic that comes with an explorable world. It works for turn-based RPGs because you're using your imagination for the battles too. No one actually takes turns hitting each other, so you're already invested in the fact that this world is just a representation of what's actually happening. But for some reason, it just doesn't work when it's not a full RPG. Also, the first time you get into an encounter, you'd assume you go right, right? Because that's how games work. Well, this is how my first few battles looked.
It's exciting.
When you do actually get into the battles, luckily the side-scrolling makes for more accurate attacks since you're not constantly trying to jostle for the right direction to hit the enemy like in the original.
Wrong! 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 It's wrong! Wrong!
Wrong.
In the 6 years since his first adventure, Link's arms have decided not to grow with his body, giving him this stumpy attack. His reach is less than ideal, and while the full health beam blast carries over to this game, the years have also not been kind to it, since it really only makes up the distance of what Link's arms should have reached if he didn't have a congenital limb defect. This isn't noticeable right away. The enemies at the very beginning mostly just walk into you, so it's just about timing your teeny tiny itty bitty sword swings at the right time. But this is not a strategy that you should get used to. Eventually you come to a town, which is another new addition and what will become a very important staple in future Zelda games that usually serve to give you an idea of what to do and where to go. This helps, since the only other places to go at this point are caves where everything is dark, and I'm obviously missing something, so the townsfolk will give you vague hints as to what to do in your adventure. I mean, Zelda 1 had old men in caves hanging about waiting to drop some cryptic wisdom, so it's nice to rock up into town, get some healing done, and stumble across a small child. Hello, small child. Dost thou have some knowledge for me? Thank you, boy. You are a very wise and brilliant child. The candle will serve me well in the caves. West we go! I'm just gonna tell you now, it is not west. It's northeast, like way up in the corner. The opposite of west. Stupid children. In this next part, I'm gonna talk about Parappa Palace, the first dungeon in Zelda 2. This is where it becomes really evident that the game is really difficult. Not just difficult, brutally hard, and just simply unfair. It hurts to do it. Like, I want to review all the games, but, and I know I have to complete them to do that. But I didn't want to. It's not my fault. I don't have the patience or fortitude to endure the hellscape of madness. I'm not being dramatic, I swear. Look. Coming down this lift, I mean, when you're eventually allowed to get down. Thank you. So these enemies are easy. Everything's going great. And then this guy shows up and it's a goddamn skeleton. And this is where Zelda 2's battle system kicks into high gear. Nowadays, we obviously have access to games with an unlimited scale of complex combat mechanics, making every fight look like a choreographed fight sequence from a high budget movie. Back then though, I mean, there was just this. But somehow, they ingeniously managed to figure out how to get as close as possible to a back and forth fight scene that you may see in a movie, with a bit of imagination, obviously. The block and parry system of The Adventure of Link is really quite something. It's incredibly satisfying, blocking an incoming attack and following up with a stab. To block, you simply have to be stood or crouched in the direction of the incoming attack, and Link's shield will do the rest, as the enemy has the capability to swap between the two planes of attack. This makes for a visually stimulating battle that makes every fight seem like its own struggle. The problem is, it immediately becomes apparent that this mechanic does not quite work in your favour. Because while these skeletons are fun to duel with, just a few minutes later, you'll run into your first Iron Knuckle. I'm just gonna let my first encounter with said Iron Knuckle speak for itself. You know what would make me not want to kill myself? Link having properly proportioned arms so I don't have to be a pixel away to land an attack. Do you know what else would be cool? If my bloody zappy sword zapped any other enemy stronger than a blob. The original Zelda is coming off really well here because, once again, I compare the two. In that game, anyone was susceptible to a zapping. It becomes really useless really fast. and I'd like to actually get through this dungeon without dying and having to start from the beginning of the game again. Even worse, if you manage to get through the Iron Knuckle and you're low on health, you've got these guys to get through, and while much easier than Iron Knuckles, there's still every chance you might. But if you manage to get through the Iron Knuckle and the skeletons, well then I hope you knew to get the key first, because if not, you've done it all for nothing. And because you have to go back and get it, they will have all respawned when you come back. There's also things like this, which sometimes feel like they're completely unavoidable. Jesus Christ, it's coming up the lift! And if after all this you're low on health and are too afraid to go forward like I was, since these big red jars that clearly look like health potions are actually magic potions, then you have to leave the dungeon and either hope that a fairy shows up on the random encounters, or travel all the way back to a village, heal up, come back, and try again. Only to realise if you'd gotten a few screens further, there was actually a fairy that could heal you. My rule from the last game applies to this too. If you're going to brave this game in its original state, get a walkthrough. Don't sleep on the walkthrough, it's your friend. I do like the dungeon design. Having multiple floors that you can go between gives dungeon crawling a cool sense of height and exploration. But the downfall, again, as I just showed, it's unfortunate that it may lead to you spending ages fighting and dying at the hands of a hard enemy, only to realise it wasn't the right way. But if you're skilled enough, you'll survive the onslaught of the multiple Iron Knuckles you have to fight, sometimes in a row. Get the key, grab the candle that was definitely not West.
Da 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 da!
Grab the other key and fight the boss. And if normal enemies are hard, what am I about to walk into for the dungeon boss? It must be so much harder. Nah, just stab him in the head multiple times and he dies. Zelda 2 as it is not something I can recommend you go and pick up and play, even as a look back at where Zelda started. The visuals in some places are obviously more impressive than the first. Link looks like a mostly normal person as opposed to a weird imp boy with green eyebrows. The music has some of the best Zelda has to offer. The combat is so close to being truly great, but is let down by the difficulty curve of the enemies at the start and discourages the player from wanting to carry on for fear of it only getting harder, which it does. It's a reoccurring theme in this game, having some really great ideas that ultimately have poor execution. However, it is possible to play this game in a state that majorly improves everything. On the Nintendo Switch, if you have an online subscription, you can play a version of Zelda 2 that has you with all max stats, all the attacks, and in possession of all the spells. Now this is a great way to experience this game. Don't get me wrong, it's still completely broken, but at least this time it's entirely in your favour. You get the down stab immediately, making getting through areas so much more fun and satisfying. Seriously, there were times I felt like I was playing a modern side-scroller, flying through enemies with my cool abilities, not in constant fear of dying and wasting time fighting my way back to where I was only to die again. And if you end up low on health somehow, get those spells out, or you know, rewind it. The bosses end up being completely useless and die in one shot, which is where you realise you've gone too far.
You're too powerful, Link! What have you become?
It really makes me wish that there was a balance between these two extremes of these versions, where Zelda 2 could have been a lot more approachable from the get-go. And look, maybe it's just because I'm terrible and couldn't be bothered grinding to get to a point where I wasn't open to imminent death every time I left Zelda's palace, and that's more a reflection on me being bad at the game, I'll admit that. But if you are going to play this game for the first time and haven't played a game like this before, then it's all about the cheats. So, not what I expected. When I sought out to review this game, I didn't know it was going to go in this direction, but I suppose it's only natural when I reviewed the Black Sheep of the Zelda franchise that the review itself would be different. In summary, I wouldn't recommend that you play this game, which is so weird because I would never recommend someone not play a Zelda game. This is just the weird anomaly in the franchise where it's not quite worth it. Even with the weird Switch version that makes you an overpowered monster. To be quite honest, if I had the ability to go back in time and tell myself not to play this game,
But if I were going to recommend you play this game, it would be for the novelty, to see where The Legend of Zelda is now and to see exactly where it came from. It's interesting to see where one of the most prolific franchises ever came from. It also...
What? I need you to forget what you're about to do next.
Don't do it. You don't have to!